Upon his return to Mexico in 2000, Fernando founded Fernando Romero Enterprise, an award-winning practice with several landmarks in its portfolio of built works. His projects translate contemporary moments of society and culture into built form, achieving groundbreaking results through advanced technological application, design research, and a commitment to green infrastructure, as evidenced in his collaboration with Norman Foster on a project for a new airport in Mexico City that you may have seen. The concept of translation, the title of his lecture tonight, embodies his understanding of architecture using design to transform complex material, social and cultural conditions into building and places with unique structured identities. Fernando's dedication to research has led to the publication of several volumes, including Translation 2005, Hyperborder 2007, and Simplexity in 2010. Please join me in welcoming Fernando Romero.
Thank you very much for the introduction. It's a great honor to be with you in Miami this afternoon. So I want to start with sharing with you some of the things that has touched me during my life, in which I arrived accidentally to become an architect. I start with this drawing by Eiffel, which is the design for the Tower in Paris competition. And I have been always fascinated of buildings that, in the case of Eiffel Tower, were buildings that require a lot of risks, but also buildings that are only possible through a lot of knowledge sharing and a lot of collaborations. In the case of the Eiffel Tower, was the first time that, of course, they needed to solve how to bring people to the top. So also great projects are always very connected with solving complex problems and innovation. But for me, architecture is also a translation for a specific moment and place. When you see the type of buildings that were happening at that time, when you see the technology of the time of the Eiffel Tower, the type of cars, the type of infrastructure that was used at that time, then you realize how important it is that great buildings are connected with a specific time. You see the image in orange. There is a factory of gold that almost resembles one of the legs of the Eiffel Tower, and you see how connected is architecture with the latest technologies in the way in which we build. But for me also, architecture is very connected with the time and with the place. When you see the same Eiffel Tower in China, it completely lost its sense. But when you see the same Eiffel Tower reproduced for a show in Paris inside the Grand Palais for Chanel, it becomes almost just an scenography, almost like a cartoon of the same building, right? Architecture at the end must solve problems. Well, when it doesn't have that same function, it completely lost its meaning. And the first building I want to share with you is a museum that I designed in Mexico. And this museum happened in a specific moment in the history where the resources from public institutions has shifted to private institutions. And in the case of museums, landscapes over the last 25 years, important business people in different parts of the world build their own museums with great architects. In the case of the family in Seoul, Korea that were controlling Samsung, they built with Jan Nobel and Kurkas their own museums. In the case of France, Arnault asked Frank Gehry to do his museum in the park in Paris. The Waltons in the United States have, at the same time, do their own museum. And it was in this specific moment when we were requested by Carlos Slim, a visionary entrepreneur from Mexico, to design a museum for his collection. And the proposal was, okay, let's try to do a vertical museum in which we stack all the exhibition floors vertically, less connected with ramps. And also let's use some of the companies that the client is used for other purposes. So the structure that you see there in red was built with one of the companies of the client. The collection of the client was very diverse in its contents. It was varying from a collection of spoons, for example, passing from paintings, sculptures, or to cars. So we thought that it was interesting to do a building which each of the floors can have its own geometry, size, and its own conditions. Here you see the museum in the center of the image, and you see how we built the museum, and immediately, almost like a wave of new development happened, bringing more than 2 million square meters of construction, 20 million square feet of new development, and mixed use, the biggest transformation of the city at that time. And this is how we built the project. So we create a ring of concrete, 28 columns of steel, and then we wrap it with an aluminum facade. In principle, the building, when you make the cut, you have 28 columns, each one has its own geometry, and then we hang the roof, and this will enable us to have generic singular floor plans for the exhibition, but on at the top try to have the biggest collection dedicated to the collection of Rodin. It's a space that has 70 meters free of columns, where you have all the collection of the French sculptor. Here a picture of the construction site. This has been arranged in only 8 months. And what was interesting was the client wanted to have this structure built with all his team. So it was his engineers and his own company that was building platforms for buildings in the ocean. So all these pipes were producing with the same technology that they used to build pipes, platforms for the oil purposes in the sea. It was a great collaboration with OBR from London. And since we are in a seismic situation, it was important to have not only the vertical columns, but also the rings that, in a way, brace the structure, but also those diagonals that helps for seismic movement in this very asymmetric structure, right? We collaborate also with great technologies in the development of the facade. So we have 18,000 hexagon pieces, but with a particularity that changes in dimensions. So in the central part of the building, we have almost like a belt of 43 centimeters. And as we stretch the envelope almost like a dress, then we have up to 120 centimeters hexagons. This creates almost like an illusion in terms of the real dimension of the building. The building became in itself a destination within the city. It's the most visited museum in Mexico. And for many people, this will be the first time that they will experience an international art collector, since the public institutions also have resources to build, for example, a European art collector. Here, the last floor, we have this kind of ring of compression in the center with those 70 meters free of columns where the client collects his collection of Rodin. The building became the most Instagram building in the country, and probably this is as a result of the singularity of the building. What is interesting for us is that this, in a way, becomes the best way to promote the destination in the city. And I'm changing with this image to another project. This is Alfonso Cuarón's latest movie. Probably some of you are aware of it. It's Roma, recently has received many prizes all over the world. And in this sequence, what you see is how was Mexico City in the 60s and the 50s. And I have been experienced this when I was a little kid because my family was related with urban development. This is one of the sales houses of my grandfather. And here my grandfather with the governor in some of the boroughs that he has developed for more than 250,000 people in the area of Nezahualcóyotl that accidentally was just next to Mexico City Airport. And in this animation, what you will see is how Mexico City in orange has evolved and grown, one of the fastest growth of any city in the world from the period of 1950 to 1980. But at the same time, you will see how the Lake of Texcoco just dry on parallel of how the city grow. So here you see the 19th century city, and they held that lake really dry. And now I will focus on the project that I have spent the last 10 years. I want to share with you the situation of Mexico City New Airport. So you'll see in this lower end, you see the current airport that has two terminals and two runways that are very close, only 400 meters far away. So it's almost like only having one single runway because they cannot operate simultaneously. Currently, we have received up to 47 million passengers. And the new master plan that you see on the right, at the top, is a master plan developed by Mitre, an agency in Washington. This agency has been funded by the federal government when two planes crashed in the desert in the 50s. And it's one of the agencies that has more experience in terms of planning airports and organization of the airspace. And that master plan enabled us to go in the different phases with those runways up to 120 million passengers. It's the only airport in the world that was a construction with simultaneous operations that enabled us to do during the different phases up to four terminals. We were invited by a competition from the government against another four Mexican architects, and what we proposed was to do a building that in a way connects with the history of our architecture, a building that celebrates some of the most important elements of our culture. So for us was the opportunity to do the gate to Mexico, and we take some of its symbols. So we take the X that was so representative of Mexico to arrange the floor plan. But also we wanted to connect it with the history from the pyramids, in this case Teotihuacan, then colonial architecture, downtown Mexico City, El Zócalo. And on the right, you see Anthropology Museum by Ramirez Vázquez. And the DNA that connects all these elements is the monumentality. So we wanted to create a building that in a way connects with that DNA. So this is the central space of the new airport. You have up to 190 meters free of columns. And this is the central space that you will encounter after you pass security. Here we have all the retail, and it's the space that you will enjoy before you reach your gate. We thought there was a great opportunity to do an airport that is not a generic solution, as most of the airports recently built in the planet, they are looking more like shopping malls. Generic structures, floor and ceiling parallel. Rather, we thought that was interesting to do a building that has a singular structure with great repetition, great modulation, that enable us to have those big spans that will give us more flexibility for how the airport will evolve in the time. Here you see a section of the building where you see the integration of the furniture, for example, or the ticketing booths, and how those groups are connected with the envelope of the building. For us, it was an opportunity to do a building where we celebrate the engineering of Mexico, but also the diversity of our country. So we wanted to have green gardens that receive you when you arrive to the airport. And the best way to understand an airport is probably by floors. So you have the apron level, here represented in yellow, where you have all the infrastructure that enables the planes to operate. Then you have the arrival levels that connects the people that arrive to the city to immigration, for example, and departure levels before you actually take your flight. Here are the generic floor plans. So this is platform level, where you have represented in green the separated luggage system that enables us to reduce times of connection and all the infrastructure that is required to operate the planes. The second floor, you have all the corridors that connects the arrivals to immigration. We have the latest generation that enables us to separate people that are in transit, they will come back to the shopping mall, and people that arrive into Mexico, they go down to take their luggage. And then here represented in purple all the retail area, and then all the corridors that connects to the gates to reach your plane. And finally, floor 18, where you have the hall of arrivals with all the ticketing in yellow. And then all the area represented there in red, that is security, and offices represented in gray. and then all the purple that are retailed to support the Hall of Arrivals. This is a competition diagram. We arrived there basically maybe 8 months of work with maybe 50 people working on the project. And 4 years later, with more than 500 architects working in 3 cities, this was the result. And from this image, we built basically a BIM model 300. And from that BIM model 300, then we were able to produce up to 10,000 construction documents that enables the client to actually build the process and select the contractor. It's a $4 billion single terminal in a new master plan of $12 billion fully financed. And what's an important challenge of the project was the soil, because this used to be the old lake of the Scopo. So since the competition, we were very aware that one of the biggest challenges was not only to build it in record time, but also to be able to solve how the structure would work over the time in this specific complex soil that has a huge capacity of compression. So together with our engineers, we developed the principle to build the project. And it's the same principle that you see here represented. It's the principle of compensation. So in the left image, you see a stone that simply sinks some water. On the right image, you see the same stone that is floating, because it has a bigger capacity of balance the structure by having a bigger surface of contact. It's the same principle that enables a big ship in the ocean to float. And with that principle, we develop a mega slab of concrete here represented in this model. So you see the F floor, that is all the mega slab of concrete, that when I put on top all the weight of the different slabs and also the weight of the envelope, that equals the same weight of all the earth that we get rid when we carve. So, in other words, we enable the building to sink with the capacity of compression of the soil. And this is fundamental because the terminal needs to have harmony with all the master plan. We need to enable the building to be able to move in complete connection with all the platform, apron, and runways. The building has been conceived as 18 mega blocks because it exists structural joints, of course, and this will enable us then to build the project on record time. We need to be able to build the slabs in parallel of the envelope in order to reduce time. And in this animation, you see the sequence of how we build the slabs and then all the envelope. We calculate the structure and the envelope through gravitational load, and this is the same principle that Gaudí has used in Barcelona for its cathedral. And this will enable us to have the best and most efficient sections, maximum economy for the envelope. This is an early animation where we are flying on top of security and arriving to the central space, but this is finally the result of the curves that we apply when we calculate the structure with gravitational loads. This was the first LEED Platinum airport in the world of construction, and in order to achieve that, the envelope becomes fundamental, because the envelope is only touching ground in all the perimeter and in the 18 different mega columns called funnels. So those tunnels and those mega columns became precisely the best element to try to have the most efficient building, because those mega columns are the opportunities not only to capture the water and reuse it in services, but also to bring the fresh air far from the pollution of the plants, then filter that air and then inject it through the slabs. Part of the same master plan was to have the control tower. The control tower is the brain of the project, is what enables all the master plan to operate. And because it's a vertical structure rather than a horizontal structure, it has completely opposite reaction to seismic. So in this case, the tower has 12 seismic insulators that enables the tower to move up to 1 meter when we have an important seismic. Here's a scale comparison of the master plan versus Manhattan, and to have a sense of the scale. against Central Park with the Metropolitan Museum, and then the number of blocks. And for us, the airport was the opportunity to build the gate to Mexico, as I previously mentioned. Mexico used to be the 11th most visited country, but currently we are the 7th most visited country in the world. We are among the 4th most biodiverse country in the planet. So this was the vision that the government have to try to build the new gate for Mexico. And sometimes when you visit a country, the first thing you see is the airport. And that says a lot of the vision of the government and on the development that you have. It has been proven that the airport boosts, in many cases, how you will come back to the country, and that has a direct impact in how people are thinking to do business in a place. Something that was remarkable was the project was fully financed with the cooperation or operation of the current airport. That means that all the profit of the current airport was given all the finance for this project. Some views of the construction, how the tunnels were taking form, and then how the slabs and how the beginning of the floors were mounted on the site. For us, of course, infrastructure is an investment to the future, to the future generations. So all the countries that have invested on infrastructures are countries that are investing in the new generation, but also in the economical development, social development, and in the case of Mexico, touristic development. It's unfortunately for the current president and government took the decision to stop the project because it was a promise of campaign, similar to the process and to the promise of campaign of President Trump to do the wall along the border, that we know will not solve problems of immigration or drugs, but was a problem, was a promise of campaign. The next project I want to share is Hyperloop. Of course, Miami, Orlando, and this context has been aware of the developments of this technology. But when we were kids in the 70s, this was science fiction, was this vision of trying to do trains that moves inside a tube. And there's one company in San Francisco that has developed this technology called Hyperloop. The technology already exists in a way because there's a magnet in China that moves with magnetic energy. But the vision they have is, okay, let's not only use magnetic energy to move the masses and the public and the transport, but also let's try to put it inside a tube and reduce friction with air. And this simply increases radically the consumption of energy. They have built the mock-up one-to-one in Nevada, and based on that mock-up, they are developing all the technology. They are working aggressively in three countries that are already building the first prototypes. It's by far the most efficient way of transport for the future in terms of speed versus the amount of energy that you request, because you can go as fast or faster than a plane, but using much less energy due to the fact that you don't need to bring together a mass, simply going inside with the most efficient energy of the universe that is still the magnetic energy. So they have done a competition, more than 2,500 participants, and they select the best corridors in the world, and we're very happy to be selected with our team, ARUP, and our engineers. And what we proposed was to connect the center of Mexico. It's the city of Mexico City that connects with Querétaro, León, and Guadalajara. Those four cities combined, they have the critical mass, the perfect distance, and this is the area that has received, after the NAFTA was signed with the United States, the higher investment. It's the most developed industrial corridor in the country, so it's the best place to develop this technology in the future, and ideally this can be connected in less than an hour. We see, of course, this technology for the future, and we think that it's maybe phase one, the connection of those four cities. Phase two, to connect to the Gulf of Mexico to the Pacific. And phase three, to connect to the border of the United States through Laredo. That is the most important point of connection between the two countries. And often people say to me, but that's a project for engineers and you are not an engineer. But the reality is that when you arrive, and each time you come from one point to the other point, then you create important development. It's basically the new opportunity for cities to activate and develop the connectivity between them, but also the master plans and the development around Hyperloop will be fundamental to imagine how the cities are going to grow. This is a potential map of the future, maybe in 50 years, or maybe even more, 100 years, of how that technology can connect the world. We are very aware that Mexico in this specific moment is not probably the ideal scenario to use the technology. We are convinced that in a similar way of how Porfirio Diaz has replicated the train lines in the United States in only 10 years, that sooner or later Mexico will develop and replicate that technology in our context. I want to talk that in my life I have been very blessed with collaborations. We would never be able to develop the design of an airport if I was not introduced and worked with Norman Foster on it. But more recently I'm working with Adam Sisa. I was trained with Kulhas and I am working with Talando in other specific projects. With Zaha Hadid before she passed away here in the city of Miami, we developed the Museum of University for Mexico City. So it was a museum in Central Park of Mexico, Chapultepec. And what we wanted to create is a museum that in a way create those topographies that translate the university that Mexico have. And we have different cultures that each one show the different climates that we have in the country. So we were representing the jungle, the desert, and the different ecosystems that Mexico has that in a way are the reason why we have one of the richest biodiversities in terms of plants and animals in the planet. Some years ago I was invited to the museum in Miami and we compete for a site, a prominent site in front of the water. And what we proposed to a client is, okay, let's try to do a museum that has in the ground floor public space, traditional cafeteria, welcoming area services, but also let's try to do the museum in which we can bring the public space through the terraces and then in a way raise the exhibition area with a promenade that enables people to visit the building in two ways. You can arrive to the conventional lobby, see the exhibition and go out through those terraces, or you can do the reverse, you can pay your ticket and through the terraces discover the museum. The museum hasn't happened, but we think that sooner or later it will happen, and it's a museum that will celebrate the rich culture that exists in the city in relationship to Latin America. And of course, we love this context because we have been coming here over the last 35 years since my parents always bring me to the city. Because they were concerned I would never go to race, so they bring me to a doctor to put me vitamins when I was a little kid. So this is an exhibition space inside the museum. The idea is to have a great balance between natural light and artificial light, and try to have this kind of translucent element that wraps the building and wraps all the exhibition spaces. The next project I want to show is in Burningman. I'm sure some of you are aware, it's a festival that happens in the desert every year. It's a temporary city that only exists for only 1 week. And I was in the festival last year for the first time. They organized a competition for doing the temple. And basically we proposed to do a structure, a double layer composed by hexagons that simply works as compression, so it's extremely efficient in terms of its structure. And the whole concept of the structure was that God seeks inspiration from the soil of the place. So in this video what you see is that millions of years ago, precisely in that site, exist micro structures at a monocellular level that have that appearance. So we propose that we can have the inspiration based on those monocellular structures. So it's a competition for doing a temple, and the temple is a place where you go after the festival to have some silence, or to remember some of the people that has passed away, or to try to have a moment to pray. Yeah, it's a contrast of the festival, right? I'm almost finishing, just to, the last slides are to share that I have fascination for housing. Since I was a student of architecture, this is the house of Luis Barragán in Mexico, one of the few houses he has designed. And this is a particularly interesting masterpiece because he was forced to combine, in a way, the Le Corbusian language with the traditional architecture of haciendas. And this is how he built his own language of doing something that was at the same time contemporary, at that time modern, but at the same time very connected with the local conditions. His own house, built in 1947, is a masterpiece that is now a museum. And as soon as I arrived to Mexico City, half a century later, I was commissioned to do a house. And we proposed, okay, let's do a house where we reduce the contact with the ground and where we have almost like a core where we put all the living space in the central area of the house. And then we put all the private rooms floating around that living space. So in that sense, we can use all the roof to not only generate solar energy, but also to capture the water and reuse it in services. The house is for a developer, a visionary developer that wants to build his own house, almost like a statement of sustainability, and then do a development where all the houses need to be zero footprint. And finally, two of the houses I am currently working in Mexico, in the Pacific. This is in a site near Iztapa, Zihuatanejo, near Acapulco for those who don't know Iztapa. It's a beautiful context. The corner at the right, at the left, sorry, here at the left is the specific site. And we have two plots, plot 15 and 16, and what we propose to the client is, okay, we are going to do two houses. The house at the right is a very rational house, very modern, almost invisible design for us. And the house at the left is the opposite design. It's much more contemporary. So the house at the right looks like this. So you have, at the top you have that kind of open plaza that separates the cars with an empty plaza. And that triangular wall, what it do is to basically avoid to have any columns in the living space. You have a very clean living space, no columns to see the ocean. And then you go down and you have the private rooms section of the building. So this house for us is almost like invisible due to the fact that it's almost revisited, review modernity. But next to that one, we are doing the opposite, a more contemporary pavilion. It's completely fluid and organic, so the relationship between the programs are very smooth. So through ramps, you connect all the programs. You have a pool at the top, and then from the living, you go to the rooms, almost like a very soft movement. This is an early study of the model, is simply the concept. The diagram in which we are working with engineers in New York, and how the structure is extremely efficient because it's simply arches that are acting in compression. So it becomes like a very, very thin envelope. And we want to go beyond of how Felix Candela was building concrete shells, because he was using wood and he was unable to do very thin, beautiful structures. But in this specific moment, like it sounds a bit absurd that you produce all that wood frame that will become waste. So we are doing all this structure with cables that are not going to generate any waste. Here view of the eating space. And here specific render of the area. So you arrive by car and you have almost this kind of continuous ramp that goes inside the house. So all the circulation becomes completely continuous. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure to be here with you. Thank you. If there is any question, we'll be pleased. pleasure to answer. Otherwise, thank you for being here. I'm sorry you're late. With the beautiful climate, I can imagine that nobody has questions because it's so beautiful outside. You have a question? Yes.
For the airport?
Yes.
My question is about the sort of the risk you had to endure designing the layout for the airport. Mm-hmm. Since Mexico's prone to earthquakes, mm-hmm. and you have so much glass, mm-hmm. what sort of risk did you confront? Like, yeah. With such an open plan, because I hear so much about clean living and open floor plans and your speech, and I thought that was really interesting.
It's a good question. The earthquake particularly hits first the vertical structures, because the problem with earthquakes is the resonance of vertical structures. So we are doing a tower in Mexico City of 70 stories, and that's really the structure will be the solution of how we basically test 1,000 years of potential earthquakes versus that structure. In the case of the airport, it's a horizontal structure. The joints are taking that effort. It doesn't receive so much force of airport of earthquakes due to the fact that it's horizontal, three slabs. It's relatively very low. I think the biggest challenge was more the soil, the capacity of compression of the soil, and how you need to be able to measure that the structure needs to be always in balance. No? So we have many measurements in the soil, and the amount of water in the soil will definitely how much the slab will move. So it needs to be always connected with how much water is under the soil in order to be able to have the structure in balance with the runways and platforms. I'm not sure if I answered your question, but...
I mean, I'm sort of contemplating matter of fact, it's the largest airport floor plan, like open space, because I saw the terminal when you come and register and then you give in from your own airport. Is it the largest open space?
I think it's the largest roof of its kind. It's not the largest airport for sure. Beijing Terminal 3 is bigger, it's a 3 kilometers building, and this is 1.6. Istanbul just opened its airport of a very similar scale in terms of floor plan, and this will enable us to receive 73 million passengers, that is the size of Istanbul. I think if you're talking about the big spans, I think the structure is very efficient because it's in compression. When you have arches, the arches are in compression, so it's extremely efficient. So it's a double layer steel structure that it becomes a very efficient arch. So. Has never been an issue that was going to not be solved with against seismic. I think when you design a tower immediately, you take the seismic as the point of departure. When you design horizontal building, that is not the main issue. I think one of the biggest issues and most complex issues for airports is the amount of floats that you have there. So you have the flow of luggage, the flow of infrastructure, the flow of people, the flow of security, the flow of employment, the flow of tourists, the flow of agencies. So the complexity of the number of flows that coexist in the airport is probably one of the reasons why the airport is the most complex piece of architecture that you can design. And probably that's one of the reasons why people who design airports doesn't have offices of 100 or 200 or 300 people, or they have offices of 1,000, 1,500, 2,000 people. Yes.
My name is Enrique Moreira, actually working in Stanford. I have a question, Fernando. It has been my pleasure, really, that we have an architect with this.
Okay.
Quality of Fernando here in Miami. What do you think about the future? what is going to happen with the actual foundation that we have for the airport from Mexico? It's just, what is the percent of construction already now? That is the airport right now. And it's just only because a political decision from a president. What is the plan B for future continue the construction from this airport? And the second question is about the Latin American Museum that you well projected here. I'm just concerned a little bit over the overhangs that you have in the design. Is what kind of technology are you was planning to use to keep this overhang just so long? Thank you.
I think nobody knows what will happen in the construction site. The progress is estimated to be 30% on the slab and 35% on the runways. The vision that the current government has is try to develop another airport in another site, so they don't have any permits or studies done. And it has taken 20 years to Mexico to have this airport on that level of development. I think one of the scenarios is that the decision will be analyzed and be rejected or questioned, partly because it's fully financed. The other scenario is that the government wait and probably a new government come in the future and try to retake that as the more realistic and best solution for the aviation for the country. Because the aviation for the country is really growing. Tourism in the country is booming. Beaches and hotels are really in an extraordinary moment. They were really just getting better and better, more construction and better marks, and we have some of the best destinations for tourism in the area, the continent. No? So it's difficult to have any sense, but my intuition will be that sooner or later the airport will come back as being the best and most realistic solution for the growth of aviation and to boost the economy and the tourism of the country. And coming back to your second question, since we present the design, everybody said you cannot do that. But I started lecture showing that you can do things that most of people say that they are not possible to be done. There are like 10 different elements that museums in Maya were impossible. How you would have a cantilever of 14 meters over the axis of the people in a seismic area with a symmetric structure? But then I think the technology exists to solve everything, relatively everything, of course. I don't see that as a challenge, actually. If you see that cantilever and that slab just built here by Bernardo Fonseca here outside, that you just showed me. I'm sure that's as complicated as what I proposed in the museum, because in the museum you have a bigger floor plan, you have that weight of the people there, and that will help to balance the cantilever. And here you don't have nothing, you just have simply a roof and the slab is just going down. So I was never concerned really, even that people questioned that in Miami due to the hurricanes, that was difficult to do.
Thank you.
Yes.
You talked a lot about water collection and a lot of your animations and things like that, like how you kind of incorporated into panels, like in the...
Sorry, I didn't know. So can you just repeat that, please?
So you talked a lot about water collection.
Yes.
A lot of your designs, and I was interested in, are you consulting like engineers about that? Do you guys come up with ideas like that yourself, or how do you, I guess I'm just interested in where it comes from. Is it like rooted in a science? Is it validated by anyone, or like...
Yes. Each time I mentioned it was, I think, the result of... I think I was very lucky to be in my 20s working in Holland with REM, and where some of the best engineers at TARO was helping us to think since the beginning, since the concept, the projects. And I brought that to my own practice, and I think since the beginning of the ideas, you don't try to presume that as an architect you know everything, but you try to work with the best engineers, and they have the technologies and they have the knowledge. So we, in the case of the airport, there was one person that only studied the water relationship to the inclinations of the roof. There was another person that only studied how we were going to clean the roof in case of ashes, because the volcano is very near. It was another person who was only studying how we were going to clean the facade. It was another person only studying how we were going to clean the air and how much pressure you need to have to send it to the slabs. So I think, depending on the scale of the projects, then you need to bring more intelligence and bigger teams to develop the solutions. But what we should do as architects is always try to pursue that our buildings are the most efficient possible with the natural resources, and try to help. In the case of the airport, you're talking about millions of dollars of cost operation every month. And that can make a big difference in terms of efficiency of the building, how much intelligence you bring to make the building more efficient with the natural resources. So for example, when you see the roof, we have just the amount of light that you need to have in order to reduce the consumption of artificial light, and also being able to reject the heat of the building and reduce the air conditioning. And that was the result of many teams working on parallel to find the best, most accurate and amount of perforation that you need to have in the roof, right? Thank you. Thank you, everybody. It has been a pleasure to be here. But you know, you were going to say something, sir?
No, it's okay.
No, please. Sorry.
Question about your formal preoccupations. I too was very intrigued by the whole, all the ecological aspects of the project. I would like to ask you more about that later. But also I was struck by the formal commitments. When you showed the two houses at the end, it was clear to me that you had more attachment to the second one. It seemed like, because this is a recurrent theme in your work, the commitment or the interest in the total figures, organisms that do not seem to be made of by the aggregation of discrete parts like rooms or wings, but just like one total figure, like the museum, the airport has that quality. But I can also go back to the Casa de Música, which is actually unique in Kohlhaas's work in those terms, as this kind of monolithic, coherent, homogeneous structure. So I was wondering if you can speak a bit about that obsession you have with that, the total figure.
I was very impressed that you like Casa de Música, and I think Casa de Música was in a way a great opportunity to get beyond modernity, because Rem has designed at that time the house in Bordeaux and was still very modern, right? It was a reinterpretation of the Villa Savoy by Le Corbusier, in which he basically reviewed those buildings with a more interesting structure, but was still a box. So when he asked me to design a house, I tried to propose, okay, let's try to go beyond modernity for once. Let's try to do something new. So I proposed this kind of double high space, and we developed this kind of organic system in which we solve all the problems of the house. We divided half of the house for the, we cut the house in two, and was half for the husband and the other half for the wife. But that project, as you know, didn't evolve, and then we were invited for the concert hall. We took the same scheme, we simply scaled up, and then we won the competition. We developed all the project, and then I came back and started my practice in Mexico. But I think that project was interesting in the repertory of projects of OMA, because it was in a way one of the first projects in which, as you say, was more minimal, it was less eclectic. And I have been always very interested to try to use architecture in a way which is a translation process. So you take the program, depend on the context, that program has specific forces. And I am not believing in a form per se as an obsession of a form, but more that the form should be the result of the forces of the site, of the forces of the product. So in the case of the villa, When you go to those countries, you assume that it's a perfect place to do basically like continuous organic spaces that in a way frame the beautiful nature. Of course, I have been always very interested in the possibility of how architecture can become monolithic, superficial structures.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.